thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. You heard everything you need to know about me. I come from Arnica organizations, as well as rivers as biodiversity are our topics. But today I will not talk about what we do, but rather why we do it, what we do. I will try, if it's possible, to share the screen. Yeah, I hope you see it. I changed a little bit title of my presentation to rivers are more than they seem to be, because that's something which I would like very much to explain why the common imagination of the rivers is not full or complete. I just try to before we start, I would like to repeat the obvious thing that natural rivers and natural river landscapes are the richest and most diverse ecosystems we have in Europe, in European countries. Rivers and river landscape are our tropical forests. They are our Amazonias. They have the most species of animals and plants living there. It's because, not only because the rivers are distributing water and nutrients, which are vital for any life form, but especially because the natural rivers, the natural landscape has such a diversity of habitats and shapes and forms. This diversity is translated to the diversity of species. And it is, as I will talk about later, there is in this aspect a huge difference between natural rivers and natural river landscape and the rivers and river landscape modified by intensive human activities. Unfortunately, whole civilization starts on the banks of the rivers. The river landscape is probably the most changed landscape we have. The natural rivers and natural landscape are quite rare. And fortunately, in last decades, people start to realize it. And for example, in Czech Republic, all fragments of natural river landscape are protected areas. Started with the topic, what is the river? If you ask someone on the street, someone smart enough and independent thinking, he would probably say that the river is the water flowing in the river channel between banks and riverbed. But that's not the full truth. The one of the characteristics of natural river is that it constantly changes its shape, especially during floods. The banks are not fixed. There are not impenetrable borders of the river. And they are not only they are changing, but also in natural river, water in floodplain constantly communicates with water in the river channel. The water is flowing, is going to the floodplain and going back. We cannot say where the river starts and where it ends. Let's go further. Yeah, but that's not all. You can maybe, if you do not know it already, you can be surprised that there is also a river under the river. Under the riverbed in gravel layers, very often there is also water flowing. This river under the river has a dark, dark waters with lack of oxygen. And this underground river is sometimes mixing its water with the waters of the surface river. There are specific and not very well-known organisms living in this underground river. And we don't know exactly what these underground rivers do, but at least we know that in the periods of drought, some important river organisms can find a refuge in this underground river. So not only the river in the floodplain, but also the river under the river. Let's just briefly look at how the natural river landscape look like. We have this surface river, what we usually see. We have the hyporheol, which is this underground river I was talking about. We have a floodplain, which is, because it's floodplain, it means it's flooded periodically. The water create here the branches, sometimes connected with the river, sometimes separated. It creates the pools, and it creates its diverse mosaic of habitats, floodplain forests, wet meadows, wetlands, and so on. The river is like it's shaping itself, it creates the floodplain. But during the centuries and millennia, the river is going slowly deeper, leaving the former floodplain in the form of river terraces. So basically, we usually, at least in the case of outside the spring area, we consider the river landscape as a area between river terraces, so including floodplain. I will talk about a little bit later, basically, but I will tell you the secret in advance. This river landscape actually creates one big hole with the river. Because the relations between different elements of river landscape are numerous, much more than the relations between the landscape outside. So we can see the river landscape as one big organism. But that's not all. Can we talk about rivers flying in the air? We can. Because the water, I will simplify here a lot because actually it's quite complicated thing. But if I simplify it, you can say that the river is flowing through the rivers to the seas and oceans, where the water evaporates, creates clouds, which are going back to the continent and feed the rivers and streams. So this cycle, we can call the long water cycle, and it's basically the cycle between water, between fresh water and oceans. But we have also a so-called short water cycle, which is local. And this short water cycle was for decades quite underestimated by scientists. But as I will show you, is important and it has its significance, especially in natural river landscape. It's much more visible than in changed river landscapes. So what is this short water cycle? Basically, it means that the water evaporate from the soil, from the stagnant or flowing water, or from the leaves of the trees, for example. And because the because as you know from physics, the evaporation has a cooling effect. So this cooling effect caused the water vapors to condensate and fall down near the area they evaporated. So that's why we call it a short water cycle. And here you can see the importance of short water cycle. These are two pictures taken from the same area with the same day. One is a satellite photo map, so you can see what's in the landscape. And the other one is a thermo map. It's the picture taken by thermovision camera from above, from balloon, actually. And it's showing the difference of temperatures, surface temperatures of different elements of the landscape in the same time, in the same day. So we can see the above, there is a pool or pond probably. And the temperature, surface temperature of this pond is 26 degrees of Celsius. We can see on the bottom of the map, there is a forest. And some kind of greenery. And the temperature is 28 to 29 degrees of Celsius. We have wet meadow with 29 degrees of Celsius. But we have also fields. It's not written here, but according to the color, it's around 40 degrees of Celsius. We have asphalt. This is probably some manipulation on parking place where the surface temperature is 49 degrees of Celsius. And we have something in between, like probably some kind of field which was where the crop was already harvested and there is something growing in it with the temperature of 36 degrees of Celsius. So this cooling effect of natural elements of the river landscape is surprisingly big, and it can really influence the very local temperature, which makes the natural river landscape much more resilient to the climate change, and which also makes it a natural refuge for not only for animals but also for people who can go there and survive in the heat waves. So let's talk a bit how natural rivers and natural river landscape looks like. Characteristics of the natural rivers is complexity. There is a huge number of different relations, factors, which influence not only the shape river, but all the functions which are in the river and the river landscape. The other are characteristics as a development, which means that the banks are not stabilized, are not fixed. They can change, especially during floods. And the river is constantly creating new shapes, new habitats with very diverse vegetation, for example, because flood can remove vegetation. So you have pioneer species going in. On the other hand, there can be very old floodplain forests. So these changes means that the natural river constantly has very diverse river channels. I will talk about more lately what kind of shapes usually river takes. But now we can say that natural rivers creates meanders, branches, islands. It has free flowing, fast flowing parts, sometimes rifles, or slow water, so slow flow. These parts of the river we can call pools. So the shape of the river is very, very diverse. If we compare modified and natural rivers, the natural rivers are usually shallow and broader. And because there is this communication between floodplain and river, the level of the water in soil in natural landscapes is usually higher, and it definitely depends on the level of water in the river. So it changes during the seasons, and yeah, it's higher than in modified rivers. So there is enough water for wetlands, for floodplain forests, and so on. As I said, there is a number of relations, number of ways how the river, not only how the river influences and changes the landscape around, also the state of the landscape have a huge influence on the river. And we shouldn't forget there is another reasons why rivers are so important for biodiversity. It is that natural rivers are natural migration ways for organisms. The natural river, there are no obstacles like dams or weirs, so water organisms can migrate, and there are some so-called flag species or umbrella species proving that the river is functioning as migration wave, like sturgeon or salmon or eel. So what are some of the most important functions of natural river landscape? As I already said, it has huge importance for keeping the high biodiversity. There is also something we have to consider when we try to improve the state of river landscape, because the river is dynamically create new habitats, and the old habitats are sometimes vanishing. If we try, for example, how I said that we should consider it when trying to improve the landscape. Sometimes we are trying to improve the landscape by digging pools, so we have some habitats for amphibians, for example. But there is the thing that if we don't restore the natural flowing patterns of the river and flooding the area, for example, these artificial pools will disappear, and so we will have to create it, restore it, dig it again. While in the natural river landscape, these kind of habitats are rising and vanishing naturally, so we don't have to do anything if we have natural river. Another important function, ecological function of the natural rivers and natural river landscape is cleaning of the water. The cleaning of the water is done mostly, again, I'm simplifying, but it's done mostly by microorganisms, which create layers on different shapes of on rocks, on dead wood in the water. So if you have very complex and diverse shape of the river channel, there is much more space for these microorganisms to live on. And so the self-cleaning capacity of natural rivers are many times higher than self-cleaning capacity of modified rivers. Another function of the natural river landscape is prevention of floods and droughts. Because if we allow the natural river to flood the areas where it makes no damage in the forests, in the meadows. We can imagine that all this water which is stored in the area is not going to the cities to make a damage. So where it is a lot of water, the water goes to the natural river landscape, stay there for a while, and slowly go back to the river. So this natural river landscape is preventing the damages caused by flood, but also it is preventing the drought because it keeps water for a longer time. And as I explained on these pictures from thermo camera, the rivers and natural river landscape also regulate microclimate. So if you have bigger fragments of natural river landscape, it can be also important not only locally but also regionally. So let's compare how the natural or close to natural river and modified river looks like. Usually, modifying the river means to straighten it, to make it deeper, and make the river channel with higher capacity. So basically, the goal was to keep the water all the time in the river channel, so it will never flood area around, which works very well in case of normal and middle-sized floods. But because, of course, it was done because we want to use the land close to the river. So we have buildings and different the arable land and so on close to the river banks, then if there is a big flood, it caused a lot of damage. And also, if you modified like big part of the river system, it means that there is no space for water to flood the river landscape without damage. So all the water is going through the channel. So the huge floods are more probable than in the case of that you have big fragments of natural river landscape. As you see, some other differences which I didn't mention, the water in modified river channels get faster flow. So to compensate it, you have to build different structures. You have to solidify the embankments so the fast flowing rivers is not eroding them. You have to build different structures to slow the water, which are different like weirs and the transversal, other kind of transversal objects in the river. Usually, if very often, as I said, we do these changes to use intensively the land around the river, for example, for arable fields, which also means that the everything, every chemical compound which is used on the fields is going directly to the river. While in the natural river landscape, you have greenery, meadows on the banks, which are able to catch and transform many of these chemical compounds to something less damaging. So why did we modify the rivers and streams? And in Europe, we did a huge, huge portion of a river network to look like exactly like this. We do it to get land for agriculture or settlement, as I said. And also, such modified watercourse has a function that it drains the fields. because especially if we are like growing grain, wheat or maize or anything, let's stay with wheat and rye and other grass like plants. We can imagine that in the past they were grasses growing especially in rather dry areas. So to create good conditions for them, we cannot have them like flooded for a long time. Too much water is destroying them. So to have a really intensive use of the land, we have to drain it. Other reasons is the protection from floods. We not only try to keep the water all the time in the river channel so it doesn't flood anything, which as I explained in the big floods is not functioning very well. Also sometimes, which is not in the picture, we build the walls along the rivers to protect settlements, which also have an influence on the development of the river. We straightened and deepened rivers to make them navigable, because ships need to shorter distances and also deep water so they can flow with the full load of freight. We are also changing the rivers because we built reservoirs from very, very many reasons. We built dams for power stations. We built dams as a source of drinking water, for recreation, for flood protection, and so on. And it also have influence not only on the place where these dams are built, but also the whole river downstream, because any transversal object, and especially big dams, are keeping the sediment. And natural rivers is always trying to have the balance between sediment, which is carrying, and the energy of the water. So in the natural rivers, there are processes of erosion and sedimentation going to be balanced. It's not always possible, but the river changes its shape so that the process are at least a little bit balanced. And when you keep the sediment, you totally change the number, the amount of sediments, so rivers start to adapt, and mostly because there is a lack of sediment, the rivers start to erode bottom and banks. So you have the hydrotechnicians call it the hungry water is downstream the dam. So the water which eats the soil. So you have to build technical structures to avoid massive erosion processes. So you have to modify the river further under the dams. And sometimes when you look at the rivers which is modified, you just don't know why. It's just because probably people are used to rivers looking like that, so they are trying to make it everywhere, sometimes without any sense. So let's look very briefly and again in a very simplified way on the basic types of the rivers. Rivers are often very, very surprising. So if I'm talking about, for example, how high mountain rivers, you can find this surprisingly these type of the rivers somewhere in the middle, in the hillbilly areas or even in lowland, and vice versa. So just keep in mind that this is very big simplification. just to have to talk about, and real rivers very often surprise you. So the first basic type you can usually find in high mountains. They are characterized with high slope. So these rivers are very dynamic. They usually flow in narrow valleys, so they don't have place to create meanders or branches, river arms. They just, we call it straight, but it's actually not straight. It's the shape is more complicated, but compared to the meandering or braided channels, we can say that it's mostly straight. And of course, the river flow, the surrounding landscape is created by rocks, canyons, and high mountain forests. And because the river is at the beginning very clear, with no sediments, and it's fast flowing, it has a big capacity for erosion. So it's taking smaller rocks, gravel. It's sometimes moving big rocks also, but the sediment is very coarse. It's basically stones and gravel. Compare it with the river in the highlands and foothills. There is still quite high slope comparing to lowland rivers. The river is transporting mostly gravel. It creates very diverse and very often changing channels. We can see the specific type, which is called gravel-bearing river, where really it creates from the gravel different islands. It changes its shapes actually each year after the spring high water. These gravel benches are moved, the river create a lot of different branches that changes the river channel very much. In the surrounding landscape, you can find usually mosaic of forests and grassland, and which is quite important. These gravel benches are without vegetation, so they create specific habitats for some species which cannot find this type of habitats anywhere else. So it also have a contribution to biological diversity. And typical lowland rivers, there is a mild slope. The river is carrying very fine sediments, sand or clay, particles like that. There is more sedimentation than erosion, and usually the natural river is meandering like that. And again, in the surrounding areas, in natural river landscape, you can find a mosaic of meadows, floodplain forests, and wetlands. And we are now close to the sea, again simplifying, because you can find river deltas also inland. But let's say the most typical river deltas are in the places where the river is flowing to the sea or lake. Usually the deltas, not always, but usually the deltas are consisting of a lot of different river branches and wetlands in between. There is extensive sedimentation. And these river deltas specifically belong to the richest ecosystems on the earth. Most of them are protected as national parks. They are important area for birds. And in Europe, basically the most diverse river deltas. The river delta is probably delta of Donau River. It's not the biggest. The biggest delta is the delta of Volga River. But Danube river delta is very well preserved, and it's really very beautiful and biologically diverse landscape. Yeah, and because we lost so much of the natural rivers and natural river landscape in last decades in Europe, we are trying to somehow compensate for this damage by trying to make rivers again more natural, closer to natural. Of course, it's very difficult because the rivers were modified for a reason, and the reasons are usually still there. So many people, many economic activities depend on the current state of the river, and if you want to change it, you need to solve these natural conflicts. So basically, so far, the approach is to try to restore what is possible, compensate. If there is money for that, then compensate the owners, give them the land somewhere else, or to buy land from them, so you can do something in the which is influencing also the landscape around the river. That's also the problem that we are trying to do on small scale, working with communities, with the community-owned land. There is also a problem that before the restoration, the land is intensively used. So it pays for the management itself. But when you restore the river landscape, suddenly it needs still for some time at least some kind of management, and it's not producing enough to pay for the management. And in Europe, you can get money for investment, but you cannot get money for managing the land. So it's also some obstacles which we are trying to solve in different ways. But it also something which blocks the really extensive river restoration projects. But still, the European Union is quite ambitious, and in the new biodiversity strategy in European Union, you can find the goal to restore 25,000 kilometers of rivers by the 2030 year, which is quite a short time. It's very ambitious. But keeping in mind all these high values the natural river and river landscape has, it's something toward of an effort. And because the river ecosystems are so dynamic, they can reward you for restorations quite quickly. You can it's the difference if you create the some forest, you have to wait basically all your life to see the results. In the restoration of the river, you can see some results after several years or decades. So it's really, really very rewarding to do that and see how the landscape is changing. So basically, this is what I wanted you. What I wanted to say to you, and of course, I'm available for any questions and discussion and so on.